Hello and welcome. I'm Ijeoma Onyato. Tonight, court remands former head of Pension Reform Task Force, Abdulrasheed Minor, and his son Faisal in prison pending the commencement of their trial over alleged money laundering. President Buhari returns to Abuja after attending the three-day Russia-African summit in Sochi. Nigerian community in Witbank, South Africa, count their losses following last Tuesday's attack on their businesses, allegedly led by an association of taxi owners. And at least 21 people killed as violence sweeps across Iraq in a fresh wave of anti-government protests.
On business news tonight, financial market experts expect central bank's new treasury bills policy to benefit other financial asset co-investment.
A sport news, Nigeria's Golden Eaglets tackle Hungary this Saturday when they start off their campaign for the under-17 FIFA World Cup.
Federal government seeks stronger partnership with private medical practitioners to achieve the UN universal health coverage target by year 2013.
It's a new storyline and the opening of a new chapter for the embattled former chairman of the Pension Reform Task Team, Mr. Abdulrasheed Minor, as he is arraigned before a federal high court in Abuja today and subsequently remanded in prison. Mr. Minor, who arraigned along with his son Faisal, faces 12 counts bordering on diversion of pension funds. His son is accused of operating a bank account which he used to divert various sums of money. The pair are to remain in custody pending the commencement of their trial on October the 30th and November the 6th.
The courtroom is filled to capacity as the former chairman of the defunct Pension Reforms Task Team, Mr. Abdulrasheed Minor, arrives the court along with his son, Faisal, for their arraignment. Minor is facing charges of money laundering, operating fictitious bank accounts and fraud. His son, Faisal, who allegedly threatened operatives of the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, EFCC, with a gun during his father's arrest, is also facing a three-count charge of alleged money laundering by receiving proceeds of illegal businesses. One after the other, Minor and his son, Faisal, plead not guilty to separate charges preferred against them by the prosecutors. With the plea taken, lawyers to the defendants proceed to argue their bail application, but the prosecutor opposes the application on the grounds that the application was made before their arraignment. The prosecutor then proceeds to ask for the immediate commencement of trial, but the lawyer to Mr. Minor, Ahmed Raji, objects to the commencement of trial on the grounds that his client needs time to study the charges preferred against him. Although lawyers to the accused and his son Faisal were unavailable for comments, the prosecutor insists he is prepared for trial.
We appeared before Honorable Justice Okong Abang of the Federal High Court this morning, and we arraigned Abdulrasheed Abdullahi Minor and a company called Common Input Nigeria Limited on a 12-count charge. The charge consists of allegations of money laundering, opening and operating fictitious accounts and anonymous accounts, as well as conducting transactions or making payments, cash payments, in excess of the threshold as provided by the law without passing through financial institutions. So the...
How much is the total sum of the money?
It's about roughly about 2.3 billion naira and about $2 million.
Justice Okonabang, while adjourning the trial of Mr. Minor to the 30th of October and that of his son Faisal to the 6th of November 2019, ordered the former Pension Reforms Task Team chairman to be remanded in prison custody, while his son is to be remanded in police custody.
And staying with legal matters, the Court of Appeal upturned the dismissal of a petition filed by the African Action Congress and its candidate in the last governorship election in Rivers State, Festus Awara, today. The judge upheld the two appeals by Mr. Wike on the grounds that they were meritorious. The appeals were against the decisions of the Court of Appeal, reversing two decisions of the Rivers State Governorship Election Tribunal. The appeal court had set aside the judgment of the River State Governorship Election Petitions Tribunal that dismissed Mr. Awara's petition. The five-man panel consequently directed all parties to return to the tribunal to hear the matter on its merit. On the second appeal, the judges unanimously set aside the judgment of the tribunal, saying that the tribunal erred in its decision. The president is back in the nation's capital, Abuja, after attending the Russia-Africa summit in Sochi, Russia, for 3 days. President Muhammadu Buhari joined over 30 African leaders at the summit, which focused on exploring and expanding opportunities in security, trade and investment, science and technology, as well as gas production. The president also held bilateral talks with the President Vladimir Putin of Russia, where both leaders agreed to put Nigeria-Russia relations on a fast track and pursue the completion of partially completed and abandoned projects initiated by both countries. They also agreed to start new infrastructure projects and expand trade and investment, security and military cooperation. Nigeria and Russia also agreed to work together to improve the efficiency of Nigeria's oil sector in a way that will see the rehabilitation of oil refineries through the establishment of a framework for a joint venture between the Nigeria National Petroleum Corporation and the Russia-based leading oil company, Lukoil. And outside the country, Nigeria is affected in last Tuesday's attack in Witbank in South Africa, accounting their losses and trying to move on. Three businesses were attacked and four people wounded, the last of whom have been discharged from hospital. The attacks followed a claim by a lady that a Nigerian allegedly held her captive for sexual exploitation in a brothel. Our South Africa Bureau Chief Betty Dibia reports.
The calm after Tuesday's attacks in Witbank and Mpumalanga province seems to be holding, and those affected have been counting their losses. Ms. Obi Nawanachi, a motor spare parts dealer, is one of the victims of the attacks.
I saw a lot of people coming to attack from there. They start hitting me, and they wanted to burn me inside my shop. If I wasn't having a firearm to scare them and run outside, I should have been gone inside the shop. That was how I come out and escape. What happened, I don't know. Here around my shop, I'm the only in Nigeria. There is no drug selling in this area or in my shop or anywhere here.
Nigeria's Consul General in South Africa, Mr. Godwin Adama, accompanied by leaders of the Nigerian Citizens Association South Africa, was on the scene hours after the attack, where he met the local police commander, General Kekana, as well as the Nigerian community. We asked him the situation 3 days after.
Everything was okay by the time we left there. Yesterday, I called again. Everything was okay. In fact, the police people there told me that the town is as if nothing has ever happened.
I understand this lady who claimed she was kept for sexual exploitation claim that a Nigerian was responsible for that. Did we establish whether it was indeed a Nigerian?
Well, that we were unable to fully establish. What we are told there is that that restaurant is located in an area where there is one of the biggest brothers in that town. I went there, I think it's holding over 50 to 60 guests. So I asked.
Owned by a Nigerian?
No, I asked. Who owns this brother? Eventually, I was told it's not a Nigerian. We all agree that it's not a Nigerian. But what is there is that Nigerians hold around the area. They have that restaurant there. They have another games shop around there. And because they are always holding in the area, it will be taken that they are the one running the brothers. And because of that, when this thing happened, that was one of the first areas that they went to attack.
An expanded stakeholders meeting comprising the police, the local taxi association, the Nigerian community in South Africa, as well as the Nigerian mission officials, is expected soon. Hopefully, dialogue will bring calm before attacks bring hurt and more destruction. From Johannesburg, South Africa, Betty Dibia, Channels Television News.
And back here in Nigeria, the country's rising debt portfolio is one of the major concerns for economists, analysts, and development finance institutions. The country's record high debt size comes at a time of weak global economic growth, coupled with volatile oil prices, Nigeria's main source of revenue. In this report, Channels Television's business editor, Bosna Mafai, examines some of the issues around Nigeria's debt and revenue management challenges.
As of December 2004, Nigeria owed a total of $35.9 billion, an equivalent of 4.82 trillion naira at 134 naira exchange rate to the dollar. That debt portfolio, containing largely of the Paris Club, was reduced to $18 billion via a relief package that was implemented on June 29, 2005, under the Obasanjo's administration. Nearly 15 years on, Nigeria today has a higher debt portfolio of $81 billion, an equivalent of 25.7 trillion naira at 360 naira exchange rate to the US dollar. In the past 8 years, Nigeria's debt increased by 128%, with servicing accounting for nearly 50% of the country's revenue, according to October 2019 IMF report. In budget 2020, Nigeria will sink 2.45 trillion naira into debt servicing, and more borrowing is on the way next year via the World Bank. Economists and analysts are seriously worried
that if we are to generate approximately 2.5 trillion naira from crude oil, and we are to spend approximately 2.5 trillion naira to service debt, what it means is that all again a major source of revenue, which perhaps is almost sure will be taking it from crude oil and will be sinking it into debt.
Government officials, however, maintain a different stance on debt portfolio. Nigeria is not in debt crisis, but a revenue problem, says the country's minister in charge of finance, budget, and national planning.
Nigeria does not have a debt crisis. Our total borrowing today is just under 20% of our GDP, while the multilateral institutions project for an economy our size to borrow up to 50 to 55% of our GDP. What we have is a revenue problem.
Nigeria is going through a rough patch, at least since global oil price crashed in 2014. Since May 2015, President Buhari's administration has been borrowing home and abroad for the current expenditure and rapid road, rail, and other infrastructure, as well as debt financing. The country's revenue is, however, not growing at the same pace, pushing the government into a fiscal deficit financed by expensive borrowing from the central bank and other sources. In the first half of 2019, Nigeria's current account turned into a deficit. Gross reserves now around $40 billion. At the just concluded World Bank IMF meetings in Washington, Nigeria was advised on how to rebalance its debt.
Interest payments as a share of tax are very, very high, around a third for overall and two-thirds for the federal government. That's not because interest payments are particularly high. It's because the denominator is incredibly low. Nigeria has one of the lowest tax ratios in the world.
As Nigeria struggles to shore up its revenue portfolio by way of higher taxes and expansion of the tax bracket, including other creative sources, the country's expenditure is expanding to include new higher minimum wage, petrol subsidy, among other things. Balancing the country's fiscal imbalance will require more than the current policy thrust, says the IMF in its October report on Nigeria. The debt clock is ticking for the administration. Bosna Mafai, Channels Television News.
In part two after the break, more on Nigeria's rising debt profile. I'll be joined by our development economist, Professor Ken Ife. That's coming up in a moment. Rejoin us again.